Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Sam Simpson. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial a Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
So if you would like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question. All right, it's Wednesday, Sam.
Right.
What does that mean? It's time for our brain teaser.
This person was born in Hamden, Maine in 1802. When she was 12, she moved to Boston to live with her wealthy grandmother, who fostered her interest in education. This woman created her own schools and curriculum in Boston and Worcester and began teaching in classrooms as a young woman in the 1820s. Her poor health made teaching difficult, so she took to writing. And in 1836, her health became so bad, she had to close her last school after a trip to England. That year, this person became interested in the treatment of the mentally ill and incarcerated. She started teaching inmates in East Cambridge prison and found conditions to be awful and treatment inhumane. She immediately began campaigning for better conditions, visiting every public and private facility she could access. This person documented the findings and presented them to the Massachusetts government.
Wow. Her efforts expanded the state mental hospital in Worcester, but she didn't stop there. She proceeded to make improvements across the country, as well as Europe and beyond. Old hospitals were redesigned according to her ideals, and new hospitals were created to meet these new standards. This inspiring woman also volunteered her services to the Union Army during the Civil War. She organized and outfitted the Union Army hospitals and oversaw the large nursing staff. She was the first woman to serve in such a high capacity in a federal appointed role.
Wow.
Yes.
If you think you can solve the brain teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904. Or just answer on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we added to our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
Cool.
All right, we got some questions tonight.
So we had some callers, but they're not around, but we've got their problems.
Yes.
We've got them on the board. Come on over with me. We'll take a look. The first problem that we have, and I made another one just to make sure you really understand how to do these, it's all about a multi-step equation. So we got to solve this equation, in this case, for S. We have 9S plus 3 is equal to 57. When you're solving equations like this, what you want to do is you want to get the variable by itself. You want to isolate the variable. So somehow I want to know what S is equal to. So the way I always tell my students is to begin with the side that has the variable on it, and that's the left-hand side. I have 9S plus 3. What I want to do is move everything to the other side. So the first thing I'm going to move is that plus 3. To remove it, what I'm going to do is add to it the opposite. Do the opposite operation. So the opposite of a plus 3 is a minus 3. And if I subtract 3 from the left-hand side, I also have to subtract it from the right-hand side. I'm going to bring my 9s straight down. 3 minus 3, they cancel each other out, and I get 0. On the right-hand side, I get 57 minus 3, which is 54. Now my next step is I want to get S by itself. Right now I have 9S. And the way I'm going to get rid of it is because I have 9 times S, the opposite operation of multiplication is division. So the way I get rid of that 9 is I divide it by 9. And if I do it on one side, I do it on the other side. And the reason why I'm dividing by 9 is because 9 divided by 9 is 1. That's going to cancel out, and that's going to leave me with S. And actually, if I divide 54 by 9, I'm going to get 6. So my answer is S is equal to 6. And if you have time, or it's on a test, what you really want to do is you want to check that answer to make sure. And what I could do is I can go back up to my original problem, and I'm going to substitute 6 in for S. 9 times 6 plus 3, and I want to see if that's 57. 9 times 6 is 54 plus 3, and guess what? That is indeed 57. So I checked it and I made sure. What I thought I would do is I would give you one more problem, a little more challenging than that. This particular problem, let's get down there. This particular problem is, again, another multi-step equation. But notice, I got variables on both sides. That makes it a lot harder. What I like to tell my students when they have variables on both sides, look at the terms that have the variables with it. I like to remove the smallest variable. And I select the smallest variable because generally, what's going to happen is it's going to keep my variables positive. And if you're like me, you don't like messing with negative numbers. So I know 5 is less than 7, so I'm going to subtract 5x from both sides. 5x minus 5x, that cancels itself out. And I'm going to bring down my negative 4. 7x minus 5x is 2x. And I'm going to bring my 8 down. Notice, I have, on this time, my variable is on the right-hand side. But I still want to get that variable by itself. I have a plus 8. The way I'm going to get rid of that 8 is I'm going to do the opposite. So instead of a plus 8, I'm going to subtract 8 from both sides. I'm going to bring my 2x straight down. 8x take away 8, or 8 take away 8 cancels out. Now I have two negative numbers that I'm going to add. When you add negative numbers, if the signs are the same, whatever the sign is, that's what your sign is. You add the numbers. 4 and 8 is 12. And because these are negative, that's a negative 12. The last step that I want to do is I've got 2x, and I need to get x. How do I get rid of that 2? It's times 2, so I want to divide both sides by 2. My 2's cancel. And on my right hand, I get x. And negative 12 divided by 2, when I divide a positive into a negative, I get a negative. 2 goes into 12 6 times, and that's negative 6. So the answer to this particular problem is x is negative 6. And remember, in this case, x ended up being equal to negative 6. A lot of work, multi-step, variables on both sides. Hope that helps.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All right, tonight on Homework Hotline, we visit the Rochester Museum and Science Center to learn about the woman that created the base or business model known as franchising. Take a look.
I like to call Martha Matilda Harper the most important entrepreneur you've never heard of. She was a self-made businesswoman, an inspiring innovator, and her vision changed modern business practices and even our lifestyles. But yet, she's not well known like many of the male business leaders from the same era. Martha Matilda Harper came from very humble beginnings. She grew up in the mid-1800s in Canada, working as a household servant from the time she was 7 years old. At the age of 25, she emigrated to the United States carrying a little more than $60, a secret formula for hair tonic she received from her former employer, and the will to create a better life for herself. For several years, Martha worked as a servant in Rochester while refining her hair formula and making plans to open her own business. In 1888, with the help of an attorney, Martha rented a room in the luxurious Powers Building in Rochester, New York, and opened the city's first public beauty parlor. At a time when proper women didn't leave the house to get their hair done, Harper pioneered the concept of the modern hair salon. Harper had a knack for marketing. She used her own floor-length hair to lure in customers, pasting this image in the shop's door. Harper offered personalized customer service to keep her clients coming back. She even invented the first reclining shampoo chair, now a highlight of the Rochester Museum and Science Center collection, to make customers as comfortable as possible. Her emphasis on cleanliness, stimulating blood flow, and natural hair and skin products ushered in a new industry of health and beauty for women. Harper's Salon catered to the city's elite and also became a haven for suffragists, including Susan B. Anthony, who praised Harper as an example of women controlling their own destinies. Martha Matilda Harper also gets credit for innovating the franchise system of doing business. Rather than following the example of male-owned businesses of the time, Harper pioneered social entrepreneurship, using business for social change. She hired domestic servants to work in her shop, and she also trained and empowered hundreds of working-class women to become Harper shop owners. Martha self-selected their business locations, product lines, services, target markets, and continual professional development opportunities, providing them with a blueprint to achieve economic independence. Harper's own sister, Harriet, opened the first branch office in Buffalo. Within 30 years, there were more than 500 Harper Method shops all over the world. This portrait, painted by Ned Reynolds, commemorates Harper at her company's 60th anniversary. The painting was thought to have been lost or destroyed in a fire until it was rediscovered in a Wisconsin antique shop. The owners realized its significance when they heard Harper's biographer, Jane Plitt, speaking about Martha's important legacy on the radio. They donated the painting to the Rochester Museum and Science Center in 2009, where it joined the rest of the Harper archive donated by Plitt and others, including some former Harper Method shop owners. Thanks to these objects and the work of people like Jane Plitt, we haven't forgotten the legacy of Martha Matilda Harper, especially as we begin to celebrate the centennial of women's right to vote in New York State. It's important that we remember the contributions of this underappreciated pioneer.
That's cool. That really reinforces about how many things have actually come out of Rochester.
Yeah.
I mean, world known, Kodak, IBM.
Franchising is something that is
still
in use today.
Yeah.
And franchising is local owned individuals.
Yeah, you get a donut at a place or a burger.
Own those companies.
Yeah, a franchise. Cool. Excellent.
If you would like to see this video again or others like it, head to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right, we had another student call in with a question that I have theirs up on the board. I'm going to go work that now.
Take a look.
All right,
okay,
cool.
Great.
All right, so here we're working with fractions, and we always get questions. We like working with fractions. I do. I know Sam does. This is a subtraction. We have 1 and 1/5 minus... it's supposed to be 1/2, not 1/12, and I can't erase that. So I'm going to cross that off, and it should be 1/2, all right? So it's 1/1/5. Now, there's a couple ways, and I'm going to show you two ways that you can do this. So I'm going to give myself like a little T-spot here to work this, and I'm going to tell you I have 1 1/5 minus 1/2, and I'm going to do the exact same question over here, 1 1/5 minus 1/2, all right? So the first way I'm going to show you is how you can take this mixed number and convert it into an improper fraction and subtract it that way. So when we do that, we have to multiply the numerator by the whole number, and then we're going to continue that circle along. We're going to add the numerator to it. So 5 times 1 is 5, plus 1 more gives me 6. So it's 6/5 subtracting 1/2. Now, we all know that when we work with fractions, to subtract or add fractions, you got to have a common denominator. So when I look at 5 and 2, I know that they both go into 10, all right? So to go from 5 to 10, I'm going to multiply my denominator by 2. That means I also have to multiply this numerator by 2. That gives me 12/10 10 minus, and to go from 5 to 2, I have to multiply this by 5. That means I have to multiply that numerator by 5, which gives me 5 over 10. All right, so now when I subtract, I can go straight across. I'm going to subtract my numerators from numerators, denominator from denominator. So 5 take away, or 12 take away 5 is going to give me 7, and the 10 stays the same because that's my common denominator. So I have 7 over 10, and I'm going to put a box around that. One thing you want to make sure when you have your fraction is, can you reduce it? I know 7 is a prime number, so that's as small as it's going to get. All right, so that's one way that you can do, by taking that mixed number and converting it into an improper fraction. Now, the second way that you can do it is we can stack these numbers like when you would have a regular number and like 25 minus 15. I can put the numbers up on top of each other, and I'm going to show you how to do that. So I'm going to have 1 and 1 fifth, and I'm going to subtract 1 half from it. All right, so again, as with subtracting fractions, I gotta have a common denominator. So over on the side here, I'm gonna do my common denominator, and already, because I've done it once over here, I know that the common denominator is gonna be 10. So again, I multiply this by 2, and I multiply my numerator by 2, which gives me 2 over 10, and then I multiply this denominator by 5, and this numerator by 5, which gives me 5 over 10. All right, so we're gonna bring this down now. And I have 1 and 2 tenths, and I'm going to subtract 5 tenths from it. Now you'll notice I have a bigger number on the bottom than I do on the top. And this is where kids go, oh my God, what am I going to do? Slow down, I'm going to show you. All right? So just like in regular math, I have to go over to the tens column. Actually, it's the ones column because we're in the tenths over here. These are the fractions. So I'm going over the ones, and I'm going to borrow a whole number. Now, we know that when you borrow a whole number, it could be 100 over 100. It could be 5 over 5. That's all the same as being 1. So because I'm working in tenths, I'm going to convert this 1 to a 10 over 10. And I'm going to carry that 10 over to my 2. So I'm going to carry one whole number and add it onto my tenths, or my 2. Now this becomes 12 over 10, and I'm going to subtract 5 over 10. All right, so now again, it's almost the exact same number again, because I'm subtracting borrowing a whole number. All right, so again, I take my numerator, 12 take away 5 gives me 7, and I have my denominator, a 10. Again, it should be the same answer because it's the same subtraction problem that we started with, but here I'm showing you two different ways that you can try to solve that problem. So again, math is really cool because there's always a way to get an answer, and it might not be the exact same way your teacher showed you, but you can still show her, hey, this is how I could do it. Is this okay? Hope that helps you out.
Looking for an easy way to remember all five Great Lakes? Just think of homes. Huron, Ontario, Michigan, Erie, Superior.
Okay.
Next to science, math is my favorite subject.
Well, you know, I always tell my students, it's better to know more than one way to do it.
Yes, have an extra tool in your toolbox.
And whichever way you can feel most comfortable with the answer, use that way.
Yes.
I've got another problem. We looked at some last week on something called synthetic division. And you asked me, what happens if there is a remainder?
Yes.
So I thought I would try one of those problems.
Cool.
Let's come over to the board and take a look. So last week, we looked at something like this, where we had to divide this monster. And we actually did it. And we came up with that. This was our answer. But I was asked, well, what happens if there's a remainder? Sometimes when we divide numbers, there's a remainder. So what I thought I would do is give you a problem that had a remainder. So I wrote one down. If I wanted to divide this thing, all of these numbers and X's, by this thing. So what I thought I would do is I would show you using synthetic division. Otherwise, we would do it long division the way you normally divide numbers. But for those of you in high school, maybe in Algebra 2 and higher up, you use and like I do, synthetic division. And if you haven't done that, watch it. It's pretty cool. So the way we do it is, I look at that denominator, and I say, what if I set that equal to 0? What does x have to be to make that 0? If I subtract 1 from both sides, I know my x has to be negative 1. That's my first step. So I'm going to put negative 1 in a little box like that. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a look at this numerator, and I'm going to write the coefficients down. The coefficients are the numbers that are in front. And if there isn't a number in front, I know it's a 1. So for this x cubed term, my coefficient is 1. My coefficient here is negative 5. My coefficient is, you said it, 3. And the last one is negative 2. Now what I want to do is bring the first term down. Whether you know it or not, it's the same process as doing long division. So I'm going to take minus 1 times 1, and I get minus 1. Now what I want to do is I want to add these two terms. Negative 5 plus negative 1, because they're both negative, I add them and I write that sign down, negative 6. Now just what I just did before, I did this times this to go here. Now I go this times this. Negative 1 times negative 6. A negative times a negative is a positive. So negative 1 times negative 6 is positive 6. Now I'm going to, just like I did here, I added those two up. I add these two up. 3 plus 6 is 9. Now like I did before, I'm going to take this negative 1 times negative 9. Positive times a negative is a negative. I get negative 9. Now I add these two up. A negative 2 plus a negative 9 is negative 11. Now I'm done with this thing, but now I gotta like write it. So here's what I'm gonna do. Notice I started with an x cubed, and I divided it by x. If there isn't a number, an exponent here, that means it's a 1. 3 minus 1 is 2. So I need to know that, because when I rewrite this, this first term is in the x2 or x squared place. The coefficient is 1, but I don't really need to write that. This is in the x place, so I'm going to write that coefficient with an x. Notice that this is 2, 1. This x would be a 0, so I don't need to write an x. And I'm going to bring the 9 straight down. The tricky part here is, now what do? I've got that minus 11. And just like if you did long division, when you have a remainder, you can write r, or you can write it over by what you're dividing it by. And what I'm dividing it by is x plus 1. So if I'm dividing this polynomial by this binomial, and those are the terms that they call them by, I get this as an answer. And for those of you who are in Algebra 2, they had a problem just like that on the past Regents exam, a little bit easier than this one. So if you could do this, you certainly could do that. Hope that helps.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher's open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All right, we have Kahim, our winner in tonight's brain teaser. Hi, Kahim, how are you?
Good.
Good.
Congratulations. Kahim, who is the name of our brain teaser?
Dorothy
Edwards. All righty. Wow. So, did you know this already, or did we give you a clue that you had to use that to Google on or find out on the internet?
I used to live in North Carolina, and her house used to be in North Carolina where I used to live.
No kidding. Wow. That's neat.
Is there anything you can tell our audience about Dorothea?
putting you on the spot there. All right.
No.
Cool.
Okay.
Well, thanks again. Congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all that we have time for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dollar Teacher's available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight. Give them a call.
Yep. Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, friends from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here. See you then.
Bye, guys.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.